Welcome. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present this talk. It was prepared together with Professor Mastepanenko. The content of talk, after the short introduction, we will discuss the response functions of graphene at low energies. Then the Casimir force in graphene systems, which is described by the Lipschitz theory, and agreement the predictions of this theory for experiment, agreement the predictions with experiment and with requirements of thermodynamics. Then we remind what is the Casimir puzzle for metallic plates. Discuss the role of S-polarized evanescent waves in the Casimir puzzle. The lessons of graphene for the Casimir effect, and finish the test, the suggested test, that drew the model in the range of S-polarized evanescent waves. I would like to note that here we will discuss proposed quite new test, quite new idea, which can make a profound effect in the field of fluctuational electrodynamics. And then we finish with conclusions. So it's known that the Casimir pressure between two plates made of ideal metal, the result of Casimir, depends only on separation distance between the plates and fundamental constants. For real plates, the Casimir pressure is expressed by the Lipschitz formula via the frequency-dependent dielectric permittivity of material. The predictions of the Lipschitz theory are excluded by the results of high-precision experiments if this dielectric permittivity is described by the well-established through the model. The same predictions come into conflict with thermodynamics. These problems are known as the Casimir puzzle. And during the last 20 years, many attempts have been made to resolve this puzzle, but without success. From the other side, for graphene, the electromagnetic response at low energies can be calculated on the basis of the first principles of quantum electrodynamics. As a result, the predictions of the Lipschitz theory are in agreement with high-precision experiments. The same predictions satisfy the enhanced heat theory. To compare these two situations, in this talk we consider the role of S-polarized evanescent waves in the Casimir puzzle, possible solution of the Casimir puzzle using the lessons of graphene, and new independent test of the Drude model in the range of low frequency as polarized evanescent waves. Well, response functions of graphene at low energies. It's known that at energies below 3 eV, graphene is well described by the Dirac model as a set of electronic quasi-particles interacting with electromagnetic field. Here is the respective equation. Mu is the chemical potential, which takes into account the doping atoms in graphene. And this is the gap in the band of in the spectrum of quasi-particles. This gap is due to substrates, because very often graphene is considered as some substrate, due to inter-electronic interaction, etc. So we consider the interaction of graphene with electromagnetic field in one loop approximation using the quantum electrodynamics and describe part of this diagram, this three-component wave vector time component and two-dimensional space components. There the first quantity is the wave vector of loop electrons, and k, it is the respectively C-component wave vector for the external electromagnetic field. The polarization tensor, which describes the response of graphene to electromagnetic field at non-zero temperature, is given by this formula, where alpha is the fine structure constant, and the result in the one loop approximation is proportional to the alpha in source power. And in Masobara formalism, we have rules for quantization the momentum of graphene. The propagator of quasi-particles takes such a form. This result was obtained about 10 years ago in some sense. Okay. In general, the polarization tensor is defined by two independent quantities. As such a quantity, when studying the Casimir effect, it is convenient to use the zero-zero component of this quantity. And the combination of the trace of tensor and the zero-zero component. Then it is convenient to present these two quantities as a sum of two contributions, where the first contribution does not depend on the chemical potential at temperature, and the second contribution depends on the chemical potential and temperature. The first contribution is rather simple. The contribution depending on the chemical potential and temperature are more complicated. But all this can be used in the computation. The Casimir force graphene system, the pressure between two graphene sheets is given as usually by Lifshitz formula, where the reflection coefficients in this case are expressed via the polarization tensor. This is for two graphene sheets, freestanding graphene sheets. If we have the graphene sheets deposited at some substrate, the coefficients have a bit more complicated form and depend on the dielectric properties of substrate and polarization tensor. It's important that the polarization tensor is equivalent to the spatially non-local dielectric permittivities, longitudinal and transverse. And as we know, the expression for these permittivities are much more complicated than the expressions for the Drude and plasma model dielectric permittivities used for the description of the metals. The Lifshitz theory predicts big thermal effect in the Casimir pressure between two graphene sheets already at separation a few tens of nanometers. It was predicted in 2009. To illustrate this, I show you the temperature dependence of the pressure between two undoped with zero chemical potential graphene sheets at separation 300 nanometers. Here the line from bottom to top corresponds to the decreasing values of the gap parameter. And you can see that with the decreasing value of the gap parameters, temperature at which we see the temper effects also decreases. Okay, so let's discuss agreement between the between the experiment and theory in graphene system. The gradient of the Casimir force was measured between А он котит глаз в микросфера, энтографил котит, плюс силикоплейт. By means of anatomic force microscope in the laboratory of Professor Muhyiddin. The measurements were done in the dynamic regime and thus the gradient of the Casimir force was measured. Here we can see the comparison of the experimental data shown as crosses with errors determined at 67 confidence level and theoretical predictions of the Lipschitz theory using the coefficient expressed via the polarization tensor. The chemical potential and gap of the graphene sample used were measured independently two additional experiments and taken into account in computations. The thickness of the band presents the some theoretical uncertainties in this experiment. We can see that calculation at laboratory temperature, the red band, are in excellent agreement with the experimental data. But the calculation made at zero temperature are excluded by experimental data in rather wide separation region, small, till 500 nanometers at least. And then only when the error experimental is large, we can distinguish between the different predictions. It is interesting that predictions of the Lipschitz theory for graphene described by the polarization tensor are in agreement with requirements of thermodynamics. But in this case, the behavior of the entropy depends on the relationship between theta and twice mu. For such, with delta larger than the twice chemical potential, and they are not, it's not equal to zero, we have this expression for the Casimir entropy, which is valid at region small, very small temperatures. For the opposite case, when twice mu is larger than the delta, we have another expression for the Casimir entropy. For pristine graphene sheets, when we have equal values, zero values for both these parameters, we have a bit more complicated expression for the Casimir entropy, and the region of small temperatures here depends on the Fermi velocity in this case and separation. And only for the case when we have exact mathematical equality between gap and twice chemical potential and they are not equal to zero, we have the value of entropy which does not depend on the temperature. So we can say that the Nernst-Hitt theorem is followed in all cases with exception of only exact equality. But this exact mathematical equality cannot be realized for real graphene sheets because strictly speaking, chemical potential slightly depends on the temperature. And if we have such a quality at some temperature, it will be broken with decreasing temperature. Okay. Let's remind what is the Casimir puzzle for metallic plates. Predictions of the Lipschitz theory agree with the measurement data if the low frequency response of metal is described by the dissipation-less plasma model, but are excluded if the dissipative Drude model is used. Here, as example, I show you the results for measured gradient of Casimir force between our collated sphere and our collated plate performed in the laboratory by Professor Becker. Here, the crosses are the experimental data at 90 confidence level. The red line is calculated using the Drude model. The blue line is calculated using the Drude model. So this plasma is Drude, so we can the Drude model is excluded by the experiment. If we consider the magnetic test bodies, in this case, the theoretical predictions of the Drude and plasma model exchange planes for the gradient of the force. The predictions of the using plasma model are smaller than the prediction using the Drude model. Here, the results of the measurement of gradient between nickel coated sphere and nickel coated plate by means of dynamic atomic force microscope in the laboratory of Professor Mohidin are shown. In the differential measurement by Professor Decker, the experimentally concerned force signal calculated using the plasma model differs by up to a factor 1000 from the excluded signal calculated using the Drude model. So, and theoretically, the metallic plates with perfect crystal lattices, which is the equilibrium system in thermodynamics, the Casimir entropy calculated using the Drude model violates the Nernst heat theorem, because the value entropy at zero temperature depends is negative and depends on the parameters of the system. At the same time, if the plasma model is used, the Nernst heat theorem is satisfied. So, to understand what is the root of the problem, let's discuss the role of the S-polarized evanescent waves in the Casimir puzzle. It's known that at large separation in so-called high temperature limit, at room temperature, such separation, the Casimir pressure predicted by the Drude and plasma models differs by a factor 2 exactly. The total pressure can be presented as a sum of contribution from the propagating waves and evanescent waves. So at very large separation, at room temperature above 6 micrometers, the propagating waves may be presented in such an expression using the Lifshitz theory along the real frequency axis. And the contribution of evanescent waves simulates pressure. So the difference only in the limits of this integration. Well, if we use the Drude model, it was calculated that the contribution of S-polarized propagating waves is equal to this. The contribution of the propagating P-polarized is the same. The contribution of the evanescent S-polarized wave is equal by the value, but with the opposite sign than the contribution of propagating waves. And the propagating of purple rice evanescent groups is equal to zero. For the plasma model, it holds that the contributions of the propagating waves, S polarized and P polarized, are the same as for the Drude model. But the propagations of evanescent waves in both cases, the S polarized and P polarized waves are equal to zero. So thus, the total difference between the theoretical predictions obtained using the Drude and plasma models is fully determined by the S-polarized evanescent waves. Okay. So what lessons follows from graphene for the Casimir path? Why the Lipschitz theory is in agreement with the measurement data for graphene and is in disagreement with the data for metals described by the well-established Drude model. The problem is that the response function of graphene at low energies contributing to the Casimir force at experimental separation that derived on the basis of first principles of quantum electrodynamics. These response functions are unique in that they describe the dissipation properties of graphene on the basis of first principles of the quantum electrodynamics. These functions are spatially non-local and implicable to both the propagating and evanescent waves. As to Drude model, it is of phenomenological character. The most of its confirmations belong to the area of propagating waves. Even in cases when the evanescent waves investigated experimentally, the most results are obtained for P-polarized evanescent waves. And the results for evanescent waves, S-polarized, only at rather small values of momentum, only slightly exceeding the value of frequency divided by the velocity of light. So, this means that the Drude model is lacking of confirmation in the region of extremely evanescent S-polarized fields, which are responsible for the Casimir puzzle for metallic test bodies. Based on this, and using the analogy with graphene, the phenomenological spatially non-local permittivity was proposed in such a form, the trace dielectric permittivity with some additional multiple depending on the velocity of the order of Fermi velocity. This permittivity nearly coincides with the Drude model for the propagating waves, because for the propagating waves, this ratio is smaller than unity, and we have the small parameter proportional to the Fermi velocity. But the for evanescent waves, this dielectric permittivity deviates from Drude model essentially. As a result, the phenomenological permittivity takes into account the dissipation of conduction electrons and simultaneously brings theoretical predictions of the Lipschitz theory in agreement with all precise experiments on measuring the Casimir force. And the Casimir entropy, calculated using this permittivity, satisfies the Nernst heat theory. So the question arises, is it possible to independently check the validity of the Drude model in the range of low frequency as polarized evanescent waves? We can consider our last section, testing the Drude model in the range of as polarized evanescent waves. I would like to note that the preprint presenting this idea was published by doctors Svitovoy, Stepanenko and me on this week. Recently, we found that the magnetic field of oscillating magnetic dipole spaced above a thick metallic plate is in many ways similar to the Casimir force at large separation, which we can see the earlier. So the schematic picture is presented here. We have the magnetic dipole, which is directed along the axis perpendicular to the surface of the metal. At some high. And then with this metal, we can consider the image of this depth. So the magnetic moment is, we have oscillating dipole, so the magnetic moment depends on the time. Okay. Under the condition that the size of this dipole is much smaller than the wavelength of oscillation, the components of the magnetic field were derived using two methods, by method of images and by the Green function method with coinciding results. So the lateral component along the axis is presented in such a form. Here we have, this is the reflected field, and the second is the field of the dipole itself. Similar expression we have for the y component of the field with change x with y. And for that component of the field, a bit more complicated. So for the experiment, we suggest the scheme. When we consider the lateral component along the x-axis at the point Z, exactly at the height of the dipole. In this case, all field is determined only by the evanescent reflection wave. It's clear because for typical experimental parameters shown here, the contribution of propagating waves is suppressed by the factor 10^-27 power. And the electric field is suppressed by also the factor 10^-9. The oscillating magnetic dipole can be realized as a small, for example, 1 millimeter coil. Then the magnetic moment can be calculated. And for typical parameters given here, we obtain the value of the magnetic moment, which was used for preliminary estimation of the field which can be measured. Here, the results of computation for the real and imaginary parts of the field are presented. The blue line are computed using the Drude model for description of the metal at different values of the frequency. The red line is computed using the plasma model for the description of the metal. And in the case of plasma model, the result computation doesn't depend on the frequency. And the imaginary part in the case of plasma models is exactly equal to zero. These figures clearly demonstrate that by measuring the lateral component of the magnetic field, we can either confirm or exclude the validity of the Drude model as a response function to the low frequency as polarized evanescent fields. And I would like to note that magnetic fields to be measured in this experiment are by several orders of magnitude large than the resolution limit. Thus, if we estimate the field in Tesla, the measured field is of the order 10 in minus 8 power of Tesla. But the resolution limit in magnetic measurements is of the order of 10 in minus 13 power. So they are quite measurable. Okay, let's finish with conclusion. First, the response function of material is the central concept of fluctuational electrodynamics. And it is desirable to have reliable information about it. Second, high precision measurements of the Casimir force caused serious doubts upon the validity of the Drude model in the range of low frequency as polarized evanescent fields. Third, similar measurements with graphene systems are in a very good agreement with theoretical predictions of the Lipschitz theory using the spatially non-local response function found on the basis of first principles of quantum electrodynamics. And fourth, we propose the decisive independent experimental test, which will show whether or not the Drude model is applicable in the range of low frequency and polarized evanescent fields. Thank you for attention.
Time for questions.
Yes, hello. Thank you very much for your talk. This is Igor Bondarev here, and I have a question. When you present your equation with addition term, linear in K, for the electric response function, so you introduce it manually in there. The question is, did you also try to modify the reflection coefficients to include this term in there as well? Because the originally should come from reflection coefficients, is that right? So
you see, we use the usual form of reflection coefficient expressed via the surface impedance. And when we have the longitudinal and transverse dielectric functions, then there are standard rules how the surface impedance is expressed via these quantities. So two steps: when we modify the dielectric permittivity, then we should calculate what we obtain for the surface impedance and use this surface impedance in the standard reflection coefficients, which are expressed via surface impedance.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I had a question about your model for graphene. I was wondering, you mentioned that for low frequencies below about 3 eV that you can use this Dirac model. And I was wondering if you were to look at very short separations, maybe a few nanometers, if you have to make other corrections to incorporate high frequency components or how you deal with that.
This was only to demonstrate the large thermal effect at low frequencies. Surely he makes the computations for the, for instance, for experiment percent and so small separations, we should take into account the interband transition like it was done for the metals usually when we add the optical data to the Drude plasma models.
Thanks.
Hi, Galina. This is Kim Elton. I hope you're doing well. Very interesting talk. Lots to think about. I had a question about your phenomenological model. Again, yesterday Ricardo Deca showed that his new data shows it disagreement with the plasma model for shard separations, but then it seems begun much closer to the Drude model, if you like, for large separations. And what does your phenomenological model say for large separations?
It's large separation, the phenomenological model is more and more close to plasma model. It is like plasma model in the limit of very large separation coincide with the ideal metal result. But for this phenomenological model, this occurs at much more larger separation than for the plasma model.
So you're saying it will not agree with Ricardo's data for larger distances, like 6 microns or something?
No. If we use the calculations along the real frequency axis, then also with increase of separations, the phenomenological model is more and more close to the plasma model. But not very quickly. But it is far from the Drude model.
Thank you.
Hi, Galina, Ricardo here. Hope you both are doing well. Just a comment on what Kim just said. Kim, with the data I showed yesterday, within the error bars, there is an agreement between the plasma and the experimental data in the whole range. It becomes noisy, but there is agreement. At large separations, we cannot distinguish even between Drude and plasma.
Well, you see, I show only example at short separations when the experimental error is much smaller than the difference between the Drude and plasma models. Unfortunately, at large separation, we do not have the experimental data with so high accuracy, with so small experimental errors.
Any other questions or comments?
Hey, Alina, this is Raul. Just one question. In this last transparency, low frequency to observe the S-polarized, you tell me a little bit like how low frequency, about in what range of frequencies will be low to detect this?
No, you see, the region of low frequencies depends on the material which used for the plates. If we have the, I will show once this question. If we consider the copper plate as for this calculation, sorry, I did not tell this. We consider the frequency very low, about 2, 10, 100 radians per second. But if, for instance, we will take the metallic silicon in metallic phase, which also is the metal and can be used for this, then the frequency will be several orders magnitude of larger. So we hope that the range of the possible frequencies and then the respective material for the plate will be taken, will be chosen after the discussion with the experimentalists. What region of frequencies is more convenient for experiment?
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, comments? We have some more time.
Hi, Galina. Thank you for the talk. No, just a comment, just to say that indeed the non-locality is not, to include the non-local model is not necessary to compare with the experiment. If you do the calculation without this non-locality element, you will recover exactly the experimental result with graphene, with the Fialkovsky theory.
You see, unfortunately, we did not know the comparison of the real experimental results with some other theoretical computations.
But Dr.
Antesa, in private communication, Dr. Antesa promised to compare the results obtained in the laboratory of Professor Umar with his theory, not using the polarization tensor. But till the moment, we have no information about the results of his comparison.
Yes, yes, I know you may be, but I know because I did. So if you do the calculation, is very easily, in 2 hours you can do the calculation, you will find that exactly coincide with the experiment with the Fialkovsky model without using all this machinery. Okay, it's exactly this. You can do by, anyone can do in a few hours, it's very easy.
I would like to see the calculations and what parameters you used there. Because in the computations with the polarization tensor, we use exactly the values of the gap and chemical potential obtained in independent measurements without any fitting parameter.
Okay, okay.
Okay, any other questions and comments? If not, let's thank Galina again.